The need that we worked on during my biodesign year was a better way to non-invasively detect potential rhythm disturbances in patients suspected of arrhythmias. The solution we came up to address problems of both device, process, as well as cost, is the Zio Patch, which is basically a 14-day long-term waterproof monitor that people can shower with, sleep with, and basically do all their activities of living while it's recording everything, so that if they have symptoms once in a while, every couple days, it will detect it, and then they just mail it back to us, and we process all of the data to figure out what's there. The process that everyone should follow when they're the, you know, employee of a university is then go and tell the university's technology transfer office, hey, we have this thing that we did while we were here under your aegis. What should we do with it? So in our process, that turned out to be in the middle of our biodesign year, around February, after we had just filed provisional patents, we made an appointment to see the OTL to say, like, hey, here's what we think is a good idea. Here's the need that we think it solves. What should we do next in terms of, you know, the process you guys follow at OTL? So they were like, wow, that sounds like an interesting idea to solve what seems to be, based on what you're saying, a very important problem. I think from them is more like, okay, well, you filed a provisional patent. That means you have up to a year to see what happens. I think most technology transfer offices, similar to OTL, want to see technologies out there to help people, particularly if they're in the healthcare or life science space. But that often means that someone has to go and develop them and make them realizable. So I think for the next few months, while we're still fellows and developing idea further, it was more about touching base once in a while, saying like, hey, how's it going? From their standpoint, like, hey, we're making good progress, or we're learning this and that about it, but we weren't yet ready necessarily to move to anything new. I went back to OTL in the summer of 2006 and said, you know, I think there's something here. And, you know, their response was, that's great. You know, it's oftentimes the entrepreneurs or the inventors who are most passionate about taking ideas and making them realizable. But, you know, as part of our process, we need to see if there's other people out there who might want to be able to develop the idea. And so as part of probably most technology transfer office processes, they shop the idea around, meaning they call various companies, say like, hey, we have this patent filing or provisional patent filing. Are you interested in it? Would you be able to take it forward? And the honest truth is, most big companies that, you know, don't probably think about an idea so early when it's just an idea with really not much behind it. But it's important because you never know. There might be companies that have an interest, and it's good for inventors to also understand, like, wow, there's a company out there that's working on something or have an interest, such that longer term, as you start a company, you actually have that piece of data. So it shouldn't be thought of as a, hey, they're trying to get my idea to somebody else to develop. It rarely ever happens. It's more of an important process that I think is a good piece of data. So after we did that, they said, okay, no, you know, you can license it back if you'd like. And so I was at the point of thinking about, how do I move forward? And so one of the first things was presenting the OTL, here's my plan for what I need to, money I need to raise to build a company. And as part of that, I need to secure the IP such that an investor knows that there's no issues, that we have full, exclusive, long-term rights. So that's where we were in the fall of 2006. Once I moved closer to closing funding, then we got into the real discussion about what does a license look like.